हेरिडिटी। इंट्रोडक्शन। रिप्रोडक्टिव प्रोसेसेस यूजुअली गिव राइज टू इंडिविजुअल्स दैट हैव सम न्यू कैरेक्टर्स रिपीट इन स्पाइट ऑफ द सिमिलरिटी दैट दे शेयर विद देयर पेरेंट्स। ऑफन सच न्यू कैरेक्टर्स गिव राइज टू ऑब्जर्वेबल चेंज इन लाइफ फॉर्म्स। variations, differences in characters within very closely related groups and organisms are referred to as variations. Often a new character in a group may lead to variations that are also inherited. Over centuries, variations and their role in nature have been studied by naturalists. During early 19th century, a lot of work was done by several scientists. We shall study a detailed account of experimental evidences provided by Mendel in the early 19th century, who is known as father of genetics. In 1857, Gregor Johann Mendel started working on the problem of how variations were passed on from one generation to the other. He worked for over 7 years, after which he presented the conclusions from his experimental data in the form of a detailed research paper. Mendel made many careful observations of plants and found that pea plants would be most suitable to carry on further experimentation. Then he planned and designed the experiments to find out the answers to questions that came to his mind. He had worked on nearly 10,000 pea plants of 34 different varieties. Observing pea plants carefully, Mendel noted that they differ from one another in many ways. For example, plants were tall or dwarf, seed shape round or wrinkled, seed cover color yellow or green. Thus, Mendel had chosen 7 pairs of contrasting characters for his study. One, the difference in the form of the ripe seeds. These are either round or deeply wrinkled. Number 2, the difference in the color of the seed albumen. The albumen of the ripe seeds is either pale yellow, bright yellow and orange colored, or it possesses a more or less intense green tint. This difference of color is easily seen in the seeds as their coats are transparent. Number 3. The difference in the color of the seed coat. This is either white with a chapter of white flowers or constantly correlated, or it is gray-brown, leather brown with or without violet spotting. The difference in the form of the ripe spots. These are either simply inflated, not constricted in places, or they are deeply constricted between the seeds and more or less wrinkled. Number 5. The difference in the color of the unripe pods. They are either light to dark green or vividly yellow. The difference in the position of the flowers. They are either axial, that is distributed along the main stem, or they are terminal, that is bunched at the top of the stem. The difference in the length of the stem. The length of the stem is varied in the some forms. In experiments with this character, in order to discriminate with certainty, the long axis of 6 to 7 feet was always crossed with the short one of 3/4 feet to 11/2 feet. Examples of experiments performed by Mendel. Mendel started with 2 pure breeds of peas with different properties. We here take as an example a characteristic color of a pea seeds, yellow and green. Cross-pollinating a pure breed of yellow and green gave F1 generation. Mendel called it as first filial or progeny of first generation parents. All pea seeds that were yellow, these pea plants on self-pollination gave F2 generation. About 75% yellow peas and about 25% green peas. F3 generation. Mendel self-pollinated these pea plants too and found out that number 1, a set of peas, about 25%, gave only yellow seed giving pea plants. Number 2. Rest of the yellow seed giving pea plants gave about 75% yellow and about 25% green seed giving pea plants. Number 3. The set of green peas gave only green seed giving pea plants. Assumption 1. Every pea plant has two factors which are responsible for producing a particular character or trait. The determining agent responsible for each trait is called a factor. Mendel carefully chosen the plants which do not produce a mixed result. In our example of yellow and green peas, a pure breed will have both the factors of the same type. A pure breed yellow seed giving pea will have both the factors of the same type. Let us call them Y. A pure breed green seed giving pea will have both the factors of the same type. Let us call them Y. Assumption 2. During reproduction, one factor from each parent is taken to form a new pair in the offspring. Assumption 3. One of these will always dominate the other of mixed together. The trait expressed in F1 generation was called dominant, while the other which did not express was called recessive. Assume that Y is a dominating factor. That means if Y and small y come together, capital Y will dominate. Then the pea seed will be always yellow in color. From assumption 2, the breed after cross-pollination will have one factor from pure breed yellow, capital Y, and one from the pure breed green, small y. That is, all the peas will have the paired factor, capital Y, small y. And by assumption 3, all the peas will be yellow as Y factor is dominant. All the pea plants are yellow, F1 generation. The trait expressed in F1 is dominant, unexpressed is recessive. This is the law of dominance. Self-pollination in F1 generation. On self-pollinating these peas, once with capital Y, small y factor, the new breed have any combination of capital Y and small y. It can be capital YY, capital Y, small y, capital Y, or small y, small y. All of them are in equal ratio. So, in this heap, we will get approximately equal number of capital Y, capital Y, capital Y, small y, small y, capital Y, and small y peas. But any pea that has a capital Y factor will be yellow. Any pea that has both small y will be green. Since all combinations are equally likely, capital Y will be approximately 25% and is yellow. Number 2. Small y, capital Y will be approximately 25% and is yellow. Capital Y, small y will be approximately 25% and is yellow. Number 3. Small y will be approximately 25% and is green. Some seeds appear yellow in color in F1 generation. When these seeds were sown, some of the plants produce green colored seeds. So, we can't determine internal character based on external visible character. Phenotype. Thus, in F1 generation, we can clearly observe that 75% are yellow seed producing pea plants and 25% are green ones. This is known as phenotype, and this ratio is called as phenotype ratio, is 3:1. Genotype. Genetically, in 75% yellow seed producing pea plants only 25% pea plants. Produce yellow seeds that are pure breeds, Y, and are all homogeneous, that is to have the same factors for representing a character. Remaining 50% yellow seed producing pea plants or Y, heterogeneous. The remaining 25% green seed producing pea plants or pure y, homogeneous type. The constitution of pea plants as shown by the representative letters Y and y to show the probable nature of factors is known as genotype. This ratio is known as genotype ratio is 1:2:1. Parent to progeny. A person resembles his grandfather. A girl seems to be a photocopy of her aunt. Generally, we hear such comments. These similarities are the result of inherited traits transmitted from the parent to progeny. According to Mendel, traits like the color of the seed, seed coat, length of stem, etc., were heritable traits from parental generation. Transmission or passing of characters or traits from parents of offsprings is called heredity. The process in which traits are passed from one generation to another generation is called inheritance. How do traits get expressed? Mendel hypothesized that each character or trait is expressed due to a pair of factors or alleles, as he named them. Now we know that these are known as genes. Gene is a segment of a nucleic acid called DNA which is present in the nucleus of every cell. It controls the expression of trait or character. In viruses, RNA can also be controlling the expression of a character. Sex determination in human beings. We inherited our traits from our parent. Each human cell contains 23 pairs of chromosomes. Out of 23 pairs, 22 pairs of chromosomes are called autosomes, chromosomes whose number and morphology do not differ between males and females of a species are called autosomes. The remaining pair is called allosomes, sex chromosomes. These are two types. One is X and the other is Y. These two chromosomes determine the sex of the individual. Females have two X chromosomes in their cells, XX. Males have one X and one Y chromosomes in their cells, XY. All the gametes produced by a woman have only X chromosomes. The gametes produced by a man are of two types, one with X chromosomes and the other Y chromosomes. If the sperm carries in Y chromosomes and fertilizes with ovum, then the baby will have XY condition. So, the baby will be a boy. Acquired and inherited characters and evaluation. We discussed the idea that the germ cells of sexually reproducing population are formed in specialized reproductive tissue. If the weight of the beetles is reduced because of starvation, that will not change the DNA of the germ cells. Therefore, low weight is not a trait that can be inherited by a progeny of a starving beetle. Therefore, even if some generations of beetles lose their weight because of starvation, that is not an example of evolution, since the change is not inherited over generations. Change in non-reproductive issues cannot be passed on to the DNA of the germ cells. Therefore, the experiences of an individual during its lifetime cannot be passed on to its progeny and cannot direct evolution. Lamarckism. In the olden days, people believed that all the organisms on the earth had not undergone any change. Jean-Baptiste Lamarck was the first person to propose the theory of evolution. He thought that at some point of time in the history, the size of giraffe was equal to that of deer. Due to shortage of food material on the ground and to reach the lower branches of trees, giraffes started stretching their necks. Because of continuous stretching of neck, after several generations, giraffes developed longer necks. Such characters that are developed during the lifetime of an organism are called acquired characters. Darwinism. Charles Darwin proposed natural selection, the famous theory of evolution. Charles Darwin worked for 5 years just when he was 22 years old. In the World Survey ship HMS Beagle, he visited number of places including Galapagos Islands. He keenly observed the flora and fauna of these places. He gathered lot of information and evidence. Darwin observed a small group of related birds which are exhibiting diversity in structure in the Galapagos Islands. These birds are finch birds. He was influenced by the book Principles of Geology written by Sir Charles Lyell. He suggested that geological changes occurred in a uniform rate. Darwin did not agree to this idea. He felt that large changes occur due to accumulation of small changes. Darwin was also influenced by famous Malthus theory. This was written in An Essay on the Principles of Population. Malthus observed that population grows geometrical progression 1, 2, 4, 8 and so on. Whereas food sources increases in arithmetic progression 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. Based on these ideas, Darwin proposed the theory of natural selection, which means that nature only selects or decides which organism should survive or perish in nature. This is the meaning of survival of the fittest. The organisms with useful traits will survive. If traits are not useful to organisms, then they are going to be perished or eliminated from its environment. Darwin's theory of evolution in a nutshell. Number 1. Any group of population of an organism develops variations and all members of groups are not identical. Number 2. Variations are passed from parents to offspring through heredity. Number 3. The natural selection over abundance and offspring leads to a constant struggle for their survival in any population. Number 4. Individuals with variations that help them to survive and reproduce to live longer and have more offspring than organisms with less useful feature. Number 5. The offspring of survivors inherit the useful variations and the same process happens with every new generation until the variation becomes common feature. Number 6. As the environment changes, the organism within the environment adapt and change to the new living conditions. Number 7. Over long period of time, each species of organism can accumulate so many changes that it becomes a new species similar to but distinctly different from the original species. All species on earth arise in the way. Number 8. Evolution is a slow and continuous process. Speciation. How new species are evolved. We have seen variations in a population of species where the organism contain the traits that help to adapt to its environment. These small changes within the species is known as microevolution. Now, we are going to discuss how new species is going to be formed. This is known as speciation, which one also known as macroevolution. We have seen red and green beetles can mate each other and can have offspring. But let us imagine these red and green beetles is separated by some cause for long years. There might be a lot of variation taken place in these years in the red and green petal population. Now, even though they may meet accidentally, they cannot mate and produce new offspring. They can only mate in their population either red or green and can reproduce its offspring. Thus, new species has been formed. Evidences of evolution, homologous and analogous organs. When we try to follow evolutionary relationships, we identify that some traits have common ancestors. These traits in different organisms would be similar because they are inherited from a common ancestor. You may be surprised to know that the internal structure of forelimb of a whale, wing of a bat, leg of cheetah, claw of a mole and hand of a man, if we carefully observe the anatomy of all these animals, they show a common pattern in the arrangement of bones, even though their external form and functions are different. It indicates that all the vertebrates have evolved from a common ancestor and these organs are called homologous organs. This type of evolution is called divergent evolution. We find that the wings of bats have skin folds stretched mainly between elongated fingers. But the wings of birds are a feathery covering all along the arm. The designs of the two wings, their structure and components are different. They look similar because they have common use for flying, but their origin is not common. The organs which are structurally different but functionally similarity is known as analogous organs. This type of evolution is called convergent evolution. Evidences from embryology. Embryology is the study of the development of an organism from egg to adult stage. Tadpole of frog resembles fish more than the frog. There are remarkable similarities in the embryos of different animals from fish to man. The resemblance is so close that at an early stage, even an experienced embryologist would find difficult to distinguish one embryo from the other. This strengthens the view of the existence of a common ancestor from which all these have evolved. Evidences from fossils. We know some species which existed million years ago, but we may not find them now. They might be extinct and some of them may be found in the form of fossils. For example, we know dinosaurs, the biggest animal on land, which were present long time ago, but now they are extinct. The scientists got evidences of presence of dinosaurs like animals in the form of fossils. What are fossils? Fossils are evidence of ancient life forms or ancient habits which have been preserved by natural processes. Fossil evidence is typically preserved within the sediments deposited beneath water and land. They can be actual remains of ones lived, such as bones or seeds or even traces of past event, such as dinosaurs, footprint or ripple marks. Usually, when organisms die, their bodies will decompose and lost. Sometimes the body or some parts of the body do not decompose completely. For example, if a dead insect gets caught in mud, it will not decompose quickly and the mud will eventually harden and retain the impression of the body parts of insect. All such preserved traces of living organisms are called fossils. Geologists can tell the age of fossil. The study of fossil is called paleontology. Paleontologists determine the age of fossil by using carbon dating method. Human evolution. Human evolution is the evolutionary process leading up to the appearance of a modern human being. Early man-like forms appeared about 7,50,000 years ago, evolution of man through ages. Homo habilis lived between 1.6 to 2 million years ago. Homo erectus lived about 1 to 1.80 million years ago. Homo sapiens neanderthalensis lived between 2,30,000 to 3,00,000 years ago. Homo sapiens appeared about 40,000 years ago. Not only that, regardless of where we have lived for the past few thousand years, we all come from Africa. The earliest members of the human species, Homo sapiens, can be traced there. A couple of 100,000 years ago, some of our ancestors left Africa while others stayed on. While the residents spread across Africa, the migrants slowly spread across the planet. They did not go in a single line, so were not traveling for the sake of traveling, obviously. They went forwards and backwards with groups sometimes separating from each other, even moving in and out of Africa. Human being, a moving museum. During the course of evolution, some organs remain in the organisms. Such type organs which are not useful in animal are called vestigial organs. For example, in human beings, appendix has no role to play in the process of digestion, but in rabbit it plays an important role. There are nearly 180 vestigial organs in human beings. That is why human being is said to be a moving museum of vestigial organs.
మా వీడియో గనుక మీకు నచ్చినట్లయితే లైక్ చేయండి, షేర్ చేయండి. ఇలాంటి మరిన్ని వీడియోస్ కోసం మా ఛానల్ని సబ్స్క్రైబ్ చేసుకోవడం మాత్రం మర్చిపోకండి. థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ వాచింగ్.